This week on Wealth Track, we've never seen a presidential fight quite like this one before. On the far left in the ring is Bernie Sanders. In the more mainstream is liberal Hillary Clinton and conservative Ted Cruz. And jumping from one side to another is Donald Trump. Top Washington analyst Andy Laperriere calls the action next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. As longtime WealthTrack viewers know, we rarely cover politics and we only cover elections to compare the agendas of the designated Republican and Democratic presidential nominees. We usually do it once, just before the election, to discuss the potential business and market winners and losers under each designated presidential candidate. We are breaking precedent this year because this is such an extraordinary primary contest in both parties. As Donald Rumsfeld famously phrased it, there are known knowns. In this category, we would put the candidates with long track records, such as Hillary Clinton and Ted Cruz. Then there are known unknowns, such as Bernie Sanders. Sanders has a long track record, but he is on the fringes of the U.S. political spectrum. How would Congress's only socialist behave in the White House? And even more unknown, what would Donald Trump do in the Oval Office? He would be the first president in U.S. history with no experience in government service and one of the few who was never elected to any public office. Well, some answers to those questions came from this week's guest. Andy Laperriere is founding partner and head of U.S. policy research for Cornerstone Macro, a top-ranked independent economic market and policy research firm. Institutional Investor magazine has ranked Laperriere and his team the number one Washington analyst group for each of the past 12 years, most recently at Cornerstone Macro and before that at ISI Group. Laperriere recently sent one of his U.S. policy reports to clients with this headline, "Trump or Sanders could crush stocks even without Congress." We have a link to it on our website, WealthTrack.com. His strong opinions definitely got my attention because Laperriere has always been neutral in these elections. Why is this time different? I asked him to come on WealthTrack and explain.
Well, I think what I'm trying to communicate to investors and to our clients is that we're used to presidents operating within the 40-yard lines, and we have a couple presidential candidates in Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders who are just outside of what we're used to seeing as going back really decades. And so in terms of how they could impact financial markets and their policies and how they could impact the economy, it's very different. I think it's out of the ordinary. And so it's worth stepping back and taking a look at those proposals carefully, or even just the nature of Donald Trump and look at what that means potentially for investors and for the economy.
Right. So let's do that. The report that you wrote was that Trump or Sanders presidency could actually crush stocks. And even without action from Congress. So that was part of it as well.
Right. I think the point of that piece was to highlight that a lot of things can be done without Congress. And so a lot of investors have been thinking, well, you know, if Bernie Sanders wins or Donald Trump wins, there's not that much they can do because there'll be a restraining effect of Congress. And of course, that's true to a large extent, particularly on things like healthcare and taxes where you need legislation to do anything. But if you take an example like trade, for example, Donald Trump can do a lot, or any president can do a lot on trade by themselves without Congress doing anything. So both in word and deed, a President Trump could start a trade war.
Right. And this was something that you also said, that a President Sanders could start a trade war as well.
Sure.
And what are the kind of things that a president can do that it doesn't need Congress to do that would, where this kind of a presidency would step beyond the normal boundaries of the other more mainstream candidates?
Right. So as an example of a small thing that a president could do, they could say, we're going to withdraw from NAFTA. We're going to
North American Free Trade Agreement.
That's right.
Which has been in effect for how many years?
Going back to when it was ratified when Bill Clinton
right.
was president.
Right.
But to take an extreme example, We have a law called IEPA, the International Emergency Economic Powers Act. It was last used in 1985 by President Reagan when we were essentially at war with Nicaragua. He declared an emergency and essentially stopped trade with Nicaragua.
Right.
So, for example, suppose a President Trump says the border problems are an emergency, build the wall, Mexico, and pay for it, or we're stopping trade, or I'm putting certain trade barriers in place until the problem along the border is fixed. He has authority to do that.
Right.
I think, you know, a President Obama or a President Bush or many of the other people who are running would never think to use that law in that kind of way. But theoretically, you could. And given what Trump has been saying about trade, it's a real possibility that he would do something like that.
Right. So these aren't theoreticals. In fact, that these are policies that he's expressed and the power of the presidency to actually do it. Like executive action or whatever.
Right. This law exists already. He doesn't need Congress to pass something new for him to take this kind of action.
And you feel that both a Sanders and a Trump president as well would both stop the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade deal as well, that they would be opposed to that.
Yes.
Right. There are other things, I mean, accusing the Chinese of being a currency manipulator. That's another area, right? And you've mentioned tariffs and on foreign goods. So there are all sorts of things that could really kind of upend the current trade agreements that we have and trade understandings that we have with major trading partners.
Right. Another example is when Donald Trump talks about the unfair trade practices of Japan and other countries, he talks a lot about currency manipulation. Well, the president could talk down the dollar. That's something that has been outside of our experience in recent decades. Normally, Treasury secretaries going back several decades have said, just very simply, a strong dollar is in America's national interest. That's
right.
Been our dollar currency policy for ages now. What if he decided that was an approach to talk down the dollar as a way to make the U.S. more competitive? That's something that's a real possibility. That's just something that investors haven't been used to. Again, playing kind of within the 40-yard lines of what we're used to seeing, that would be unusual. But it wouldn't be surprising considering how he views the trade relationships that we have with other countries and how important the currency is in terms of the trade deficits that the U.S. is now experiencing.
Right. So another area that you mentioned that's related, actually, is the independence of the Federal Reserve. And both Sanders and Trump have expressed concerns about the Fed, right? So tell us what they might do as president.
Right, so I think there's a couple of things. Number one, whoever the next president is, they're gonna be appointing or reappointing potentially the next Fed chairman. So one year into the president's term, he'll have an opportunity to appoint the next Fed chairman. So that personnel decision could be significant. And then secondly, you know, you do wonder about the independence of the Fed potentially under a Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump, something that other presidents have not really been willing to really touch or go into that area. That's something that potentially that they might.
Of course, the Fed comes under the auspices of Congress, though.
Right.
Right. So that is an area where Congress would definitely have an influence on what the president can actually do.
Right. I think, well, there's a few different things that you could have. I mean, now, even the Fed chairman would have to be confirmed by the Senate.
Yes.
But if what if the president were just to sort of jawbone the Fed and pressure the Fed rhetorically? Again, something that we really haven't seen for a couple of decades. What will investors think of that and the independence and the credibility of the Fed if the president is attacking the Fed for its monetary policy decisions?
And actually, as you just said, if in fact the Janet Yellen's term in the first year of the presidency comes up, one of the possibilities would be that they would appoint someone who would share their policy, which automatically would influence the independence of the Fed. So it could be a more of a political appointment.
Right, exactly. Right? So in the past, the Fed chairman have been viewed as pretty credible and independent. What if a Trump or a Sanders appoint someone who is not viewed as independent potentially?
Right.
I think, you know, perhaps under Trump, that would be a more of a likely scenario.
I mean, another area that you've pointed out in your research to clients is the big banks. And that tell us, you know, Sanders has been quite outspoken about shutting down the big banks and criminalizing, you know, going after them, executives and the banks themselves for criminal activities. So tell us about that.
Right. Well, I think if to take the a big proposal that Sanders made on January 5th, he gave a speech where he said, if I'm elected president, I will identify, or the Treasury Secretary, my Treasury Secretary will identify in the first 100 days the banks that I'm going to break up, and I have all the authority that I need under existing law, Dodd-Frank, to break them up, and they will be broken up within the first year. So he is telling you that. It's clearly his top priority in terms of addressing what he sees as imbalances on Wall Street and risks to taxpayers, and he talks about fraud as the business practice of
right.
Wall Street. So he's telling you straight up, I'm going to break up the biggest banks. I'm going to tell you within the first 100 days which ones I'm going to do. So that's his number one priority. Investors ought to take that seriously.
Drug reimportation as well is another area. Are both Trump and Sanders targeting the drug companies, or is it mostly Sanders?
And Clinton as well. So you have you have Sanders, Clinton, and Trump, who have had some pretty tough rhetoric for the drug companies. They all favor having the government negotiate drug prices. You mentioned drug reimportation, which was in my piece on what you can do even without new legislation, because Congress actually authorized drug reimportation in a law going back to when President Clinton was the president. But the HHS secretary had to certify that it could be done safely and consumers would get lower prices. No one's been willing to do that, but that authority is still there. It's something that the next president could have their HHS secretary certify it can be done, and we could allow drug reimportation right away.
Let me quote from a report. And again, you know, I mean, I've been following your research for a long time, and it's an unusual for you to come out and express the kinds of opinions that you have. And which is why we're having you on WealthTrack. I think it's very important. Intangible risk associated with Trump and Sanders, and this is to quote you, we strive to stay neutral, but with our analyst hat firmly on our head, quote, Trump dangerously ill-informed concerning public policy, particularly issues related to national security, and Sanders would scare business leaders and hurt hiring and capital spending.
Well, I think if you take Sanders, he says he wants a political revolution to completely upend the existing economic order. I think if you're an investor, that should get your attention. So he's telling you that he wants a radical change in economic policy that's going to potentially have far-reaching economic implications. Donald Trump is telling you that he has been saying he's in favor of a high tariff or other measures to change trade policy in a pretty substantial way. I think in terms of his policy depth, he's just in a class by himself in terms of he doesn't have the policy depth that we're used to seeing in potential presidents. And so all of these things are just very unusual for investors, and you have to take a sober look at what this could mean for financial markets and the economy. This is just not the kind of presidential candidates that we're used to seeing.
You know, does Sanders even have a shot at getting the Democratic nomination?
No, I think at this point it's pretty unlikely. I think the importance of Sanders, though, is that what it could tell you potentially about a Democratic sweep, which could happen if Trump is the nominee and Republicans do poorly. I think the House is potentially at risk for Republicans, and so a Democratic sweep scenario is something that investors have to consider. And so what that agenda might look like, it could be some kind of melding of a Clinton-Sanders kind of agenda.
March 18th, you wrote a piece, Why We Were Wrong About Trump. You and thousands of others, referring to his chances of winning the GOP nomination. So what have you learned? One of the most fascinating statements that you said in that piece was that Trump is not a Republican, that through, most of the past 16 years, he's been registered as a Democrat or an independent.
And he's been getting 37% of the vote in the Republican primary. So I think that is an issue that's bothering a lot of people. But what's surprising, and we've been wrong about it, is the number of people who've been willing to overlook that. And I think they're frustrated with politicians. They don't believe their promises anymore. And they want a guy they think is strong and tough. And they're overlooking the fact that he doesn't have a history of being a Republican in terms of his registration, in terms of his campaign donations, and in terms of a lot of the views that he's held over the years. So particularly given this environment where you see this a quest for purity among House Republicans. John Boehner loses his job because he's not conservative enough. And here you are on the verge of Republicans nominating someone who's been a Democrat most of the last 16 years. It's a very unusual situation.
Does Trump have a shot of winning the GOP nomination?
Well, he's the favorite to win the GOP nomination. He has more delegates. I think he's roughly on track to get a majority, give or take a little bit. So it's a close call whether there'll be a contested convention or whether he'll go into the convention with a majority of the delegates. If he goes in short of a majority, I think he's probably not going to come out the nominee because most of the delegates are not going to be for Trump. But if he goes in with
that's
a majority...
That's news to me.
Well, if he goes in with a majority... Right. He's going to be the nominee. But if he goes in with 45% of the delegates, I think the chances are it'll be somebody else, probably Ted Cruz.
So 51%, for instance, if Trump goes in with 51%, he will be the GOP nominee.
Yeah. I mean, if it's 49, he'll probably be the GOP nominee. He can probably find a few unbound delegates that he could switch.
Right.
But if he goes in with 55% of the delegates who are for Cruz and Kasich and Rubio and a few of the others, are going to be pretty disinclined to support Donald Trump.
Right. So no one...
Another fact, if I may just throw in,
please.
If he goes in with 45% of the delegates, that means he's going to perform a lot worse over the next 2.5 months than he's been performing, right? So he's been winning 2/3 of the states. If he starts to win more like half the states or 60% of the states, then he goes in with less than half the delegates. And so he will be seeming like a guy who maybe is taking on water rather than... someone who looks as strong as he does today.
So when will we know that, Andy?
Well, I think every contest is going to count from now on because
so Wisconsin is next week, for instance. That's
right,
going to count.
That's going to count. Even these small states are going to count. Nebraska's a winner-take-all with, I think, 36 delegates. It's going to count this year. June 7th is California, New Jersey, and a few other states. There's over 300 delegates at stake. No one's going to have a majority before June 7th. So. I think it's going to count. Every contest is going to count to the end, and no one is going to have it wrapped up before June 7th.
What were the lessons that you've learned from underestimating Donald Trump's candidacy?
Right. Well, I think the biggest mistake I made was that experience didn't matter, and so that clearly was an asset to him in the Republican primary. I think for some of the other lessons, they didn't hurt him enough with the 40% or so that have been supporting him. 37% of the vote so far has been for Trump in the primaries. But I think they are hurting him, and they are hurting him with the general electorate. They're hurting him with other Republicans. So some of the controversial comments that he's made, the fact that he doesn't have this policy depth that we're used to and that from other candidates, I think those things actually have hurt him. I would have thought they would have hurt him a lot more and that he wouldn't be able to draw 37% of the Republican primary vote given some of these other characteristics and stances that he's taken. So I don't think that you want to, the lesson is not, well, just throw everything we know about politics out the window. Those things have hurt him. That's why he has those high unpopularity ratings with the broader public. That's why you're not seeing Republicans rally around the presumptive nominee like you would normally be seeing at this point.
What are you telling clients, what are your working assumptions as far as the nominees? You've said already that Hillary Clinton, you think, will definitely get the Democratic nomination. And we've just discussed the likelihood of Trump or Cruz, and that's very much still up in the air. So, let's say it's Trump versus Clinton, however, what are your working assumptions as far as the general election is concerned?
Right. So, the base case is it is a Trump-Clinton. Trump's the favorite, Clinton's the very heavy favorite. So I think that a Trump-Clinton matchup leaves all of the major possibilities on the table. Trump could win. Base case is I think he would lose, but he could win. Mm-hmm. You could see Clinton win and the Republicans maintain their majority in the House, which would have a divided government scenario, similar to what we have now, although the Republicans lose the Senate under that scenario. And I think Trump, given the numbers we were just talking about, could be such a disaster for Republicans that they lose the House and it's a Democratic sweep. So I think you have the kind of the extremes are real possibilities under this election scenario. So overall today, I would say it's probably 70% probability that Clinton would beat Trump in the general election, but real chance he could win, a real chance of a Democratic sweep as well. Base case, Clinton wins, Republicans keep the House, it's a divided government scenario similar to what we have now.
So my apologies to both Senator Cruz and Governor Kasich, but let's go with that, the scenario of a Senator Cruz versus Clinton. How does that matchup work?
Right. I would give the edge to Senator Clinton beating Ted Cruz, but not with a lot of confidence. Both, I think, would be relatively unpopular. Both are weaker than average nominees. Clinton right. with her numbers, and then Ted Cruz is associated with the government shutdown, and he's been running a campaign that's aimed at conservatives, where he's, you know, kind of telling moderates, I don't really want your vote. And so I don't think he plays really well among the swing voters in the general election. Probably does fine among Republicans, but not so well among swing voters. So I think both of them would have a real chance of winning under that kind of scenario.
So this has been, it's an exciting campaign to yeah. follow, that's for sure. A lot of rules are being broken. Have we seen any impact in the market so far, or in business so far, business decisions?
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't think we've seen much of an impact in the market. That's sort of my own view, just looking at the markets.
Right.
I talk to a lot of clients, they generally agree with that. Some clients think that maybe we've seen a little bit of movement in the healthcare names, maybe a little pressure in the healthcare area from, you know, all of the above,
right?
Trump, Clinton, and
Sanders.
And Sanders. But I think overall we haven't really seen the market react much to what's happening in the presidential election.
And business decisions, again, you know, you talk to a lot of business yeah. clients as well. You're not seeing any
no,
reaction so far.
I don't think so.
Right. Given the fact that you have said actually either a Trump or Sanders presidency, and now we're dealing with a Trump possibility
right.
Of, you know, a pretty serious market reaction. When do you advise clients that they should, you know, just start being more defensive? As investors, you know, how should we respond to events as they unfold?
Yeah, I guess I'm surprised that we haven't seen more of a reaction.
Right.
That the risk associated with the more extreme outcomes, maybe that the market would discount that a little bit. But you know, historically, the market doesn't really discount presidential elections until starting really after Labor Day.
All right.
So
we have time.
So in a normal year, you wouldn't have expected much of a reaction. We aren't getting one, but it hasn't been a normal year in terms of the candidates and the kinds of things they've been talking about. But you know, historically, Labor Day is the time that people really begin to focus on it, and you can see stocks tracking the potential winners and losers. And so normally that's more of a sector call than an overall market call. And I think that's still the case, that it's more sectors that are the big call rather than an overall market call based on the election.
And on WealthTrack, when we do know who the nominees are, we will definitely cover, which we traditionally would do, is the winners and losers
right.
of either presidential candidate. But right now we're definitely in a state of flux. And I have to ask you one last question, Andy, that I ask every guest on WealthTrack, and that is, you know, is if there's one investment that we should all make in a long-term diversified portfolio, what would it be? Is there anything that speaks to you as far as what's going on in this election cycle?
Well, I think the sector that's going to come under pressure over the next, you know, 6 or 7 months is healthcare. So you've got Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump beating up the drug companies. They're both talking about government negotiated prices. They're both talking about drug reimportation. And so potentially the HMOs, they've both been attacked as well by Trump and Clinton. I think the policy risk is greater under Trump to the HMOs, the managed care sector, than it is under Clinton. But you could see that whole space, biotech, is certainly affected by the same issues that affect the pharmaceutical companies.
In a negative way. Right,
and so,
pricing,
you know,
certainly.
Yeah,
right.
Drug, you know, government-controlled prices, reimportation, all that. So I think that's the area where we probably will see investors maybe getting a little more defensive and trying to avoid areas that might look like losers either way.
Right. So, Andy Laperriere, what a fascinating job you have at this particular juncture. And thank you so much for sharing your insights and unusually for sharing your opinions with us. We really appreciate it.
Okay, thank you. My pleasure.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is don't let the political noise affect your investment decisions. As leading strategist Richard Bernstein told us on a recent WealthTrack, presidential campaigns are designed to tell us how bad things are so that the candidates can promise to fix them. All that negativity takes its toll on investor psychology. The most successful investors stick to their investment discipline and focus on the fundamentals and the companies and securities that will excel in their businesses, no matter what the political climate. This is a fascinating election, but it shouldn't determine your investment strategy. To see this program again and other WealthTrack interviews, including our exclusive extra feature with Andy Laperriere, please go to our website, WealthTrack.com. Also, feel free to reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.